Well, good morning. Let's stand, because it's good. God is so good. And someone give me an amen? Now we're talking. It's a glorious day, because he's made it. Come on, clap your hands.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my turn till I met you. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my turn.
They say these chains will never break. Good morning. You may be seated. We're going to celebrate communion together. If you're new at Integrity, once a month on the first Sunday of every month, we celebrate communion together. It's a real privilege to be able to celebrate that and realize what Jesus has done. I want to mention this morning the term scapegoat. In our Western culture, scapegoat is kind of a negative thing because what happens is somebody blames somebody else and they get in trouble for something that they really didn't do. And so in our culture, when somebody becomes a scapegoat or is accused of something, it's kind of a negative connotation, but actually that's a biblical term. The concept is there. In Leviticus chapter 19, it reminds us that in Old Testament times, once a year, in between mid-September, mid-October, the nation of Israel would have a Day of Atonement. And that was the day that they would select two goats, they would draw straws. One goat would be sacrificed, and the high priest would go into the Holy of Holies and place the blood of that goat on the mercy seat. The other goat, the high priest would go and he'd confess the sins of the nation and the people on that goat. And then that goat would be led out to the wilderness and let go, never to be found again. That's exactly what Jesus did for you and I. He took the blame that we deserved. He took our sin upon himself, and he went to the cross, knowing that we couldn't rescue ourselves, we couldn't find forgiveness in ourselves, we couldn't do enough good things to make up for the sin that was in our lives. And so this morning, when we look at taking communion together, we realize what Jesus has done. And it's good for us to remember. I've said it so many times, I remember distinctly the day I gave my life to Christ, because that was a changing moment for me. I felt the forgiveness and the freedom and the cleansing that only Christ could give us. God was working in my life for a long time, drawing me to himself. I was fighting, you know? I was going the other way. You can't fight with God, you know? You're going to lose. And to be honest with you, we know that without the shedding of blood, there's no forgiveness of sins. And so that shed blood that was put on that mercy seat and the blood that Jesus shed on the cross was for you and I, so we could be forgiven. I confessed in first service that I sinned this week, and so did you. Could be in an attitude, thought, whatever, you know. But I know I can go and I can ask the Lord to forgive me, and it's completely taken away. Just like that goat ran into the wilderness, never to be remembered no more. I hope that you're not captive to the sins of your past. Now, I know the enemy would come against us because he's the accuser. He comes against us and he tells us, you're not a good person, you're not forgiven. I want to tell you this morning what Jesus did on the cross and what he paid was enough. So if you've been held captive to your past sins, let it go today, realizing that in God's eyes, it's totally forgiven. And so we come this morning, and Jesus, when he was with his disciples, the scriptures tell us, took bread and he broke it. And he said, this is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. We come to God broken, but because he was broken for us, that makes us whole. And so we take the bread this morning, realizing that we are whole because of Christ's brokenness. Let's partake together. The same time he took the cup, and the Bible says he blessed it and said, "This is a new covenant, a covenant of grace written in my blood, giving us what we don't deserve and withholding what we do." That's the grace and mercy of God. So this morning we celebrate, we drink the cup of blessing. That's what the scriptures call it. The cup of wrath is empty, but the cup of blessing is full. Let's partake together this morning. Thank you, Jesus. I'm going to ask you to stand. We're going to go back into worship. God is good.
From the far side of the chasm, you held me in your sight. So you made a way across a great divide. Left behind heaven's throne to build it here inside. And there at the cross, you paid the debt I owed, broke my chains, freed my soul. For the first time I had hope. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood applied. Thank you, Jesus, it has washed me white. Saved my life, brought me from the darkness into glorious light. You took my place, laid inside my tomb of sin. You were buried for 3 days, but then you walked right out again. And now death has no sting, and life has no end. For I have been transformed by the blood of the Lamb. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood applied. Thank you, thank you, Jesus, you have saved.
That sin separated us, and there was no way that we could bridge that gap. But you loved us so much, so incredibly much, that you sent your Son to die for us. And then you made a way that we can be looked at through the lens of the work of the cross, pure and spotless. Father, we thank you. We thank you that we can come and gather and lift your name high, because it's worthy. You are worthy. Father, we just ask that you would just continue to work in our lives. Prompt us to good works. And Father, love those around us as we share the good news and the great work that you've done for us. We ask these things in your name. Amen and amen.
Amen. Amen. Ooh. Praise the Lord. Amen. You may be seated. Well, I'm very excited to say we've got some more of our brothers and sisters who are asked to go through the waters of baptism together. And I love when baptism kind of falls on the same day as communion, because both baptism and communion really highlight the gospel. Right, it's a reminder of Christ's death, burial, his resurrection, right, his sacrifice for our sins, and ultimately our public declaration that we want to be identified with him, right? In communion, we are identifying with the his body that was broken. We are identifying with his blood that has been shed for us as the only means for our salvation. There's no work that we can do, right? There's nothing that we bring to the table. It is solely depending upon what Christ has done for us as our only means of salvation. And as we come regularly to the table, that's why the scriptures encourage us to come regularly, to remind us of that great work that he's done for us. And then we come to the waters of baptism, a public declaration of an inward reality, right? Baptism does not save us. Baptism recognizes that we have been saved by his death, burial, and resurrection. And throughout church history, the church has always come to the waters of baptism as adults, as believers who recognize that it is only Christ's death, burial, and resurrection that stand as the grounds for their salvation. You know, in the early church, it was a little bit different than it is, thankfully, here. As I've shared in the past, you know, when people would be baptized in the early church, because Christianity was illegal, it sometimes could carry or run the risk of imprisonment or death, right? It was at that moment where there was this public declaration that I want to be identified with that group of people, with that body of believers, with that God, Jesus Christ. And it was through the waters of baptism that they publicly would declare their identification with him. While the consequences, thankfully, at least at this time in our lives, are not the same as back in the early church, the significance is the same. And so this morning we have three folks that we have an opportunity to celebrate with, going through the waters of baptism. I'm going to ask the first person to come up. I'm going to ask Mariah Espinosa if you come at this time. Good morning. Mariah, it's been so wonderful to see you pursuing Jesus.
Thank you.
Why do you want to be baptized?
Because Jesus saved my life. was in such a dark place. He was the only one that took me out of that place. And although I didn't see that at first, I was looking for that in so many other people and other things. And so he was just showing me that he was the only one that was capable of taking me out of that dark place. And once I saw that, I ran to him, and he had his arms wide open for me, and I felt so at peace, and I've never been happier.
Praise God. Well, Jesus loves you so much, and clearly his hand is upon your life. So Jesus Christ is Lord, is your Lord and Savior, right? So I want to ask you to cross your arms, and based upon your profession and faith of the Lord Jesus, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Awesome. Congratulations. That's a big step. Next, I'm going to ask for Jeremiah Godoy to come. I've been after this brother to get baptized. Every time we've had baptisms, his heart has been ready. He's just been all over serving and mission trips. So it's so good. And so I said to him, the longer you wait, the longer I hold you under. And so I think we're up at 8 minutes, I think, at this point. So I'm kidding, man. It's just so awesome to see your love for Christ and your intentional pursuit of Jesus. And that is that's so awesome. Why do you want to be baptized?
The Lord commands us to be baptized in water, and I'm taking that next step in my relationship with him in obedience.
That's awesome. I'm proud of you. Well, based upon, I'm going to ask you to cross your arms. Based upon your profession of faith in the Lord Jesus, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. All right. Awesome. Congratulations, brother. And not to be outdone by his older brother, I'm going to ask Jonathan Godoy to come up. And I know Jonathan is not just following his brothers, but Jonathan's following Jesus. Right?
It's nice and warm.
It's nice and warm. It's a good thing, right? We warmed it up just for you. Why do you want to be baptized?
I want to strengthen my testimony in Christ and build my relationship in him.
That's awesome. I so much appreciate it. You're just so full of the joy of the Lord. Every time I see you, you just exude just joy and happiness and fun. And so it's just so awesome. And to know that Christ is the center of your life for you and for Mariah and for Jeremiah, it's just so encouraging to see our young people pursuing Jesus, right? I mean, what an incredible, incredible thing. We're so proud of you. I ask you to cross your arms. Based upon your profession, faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. All right. Congratulations, brother. Awesome. Amen.
Good stuff. So I put my hand in this before. It's like, oh, I really want to be in here. It's so nice and warm. It really is like a hot tub. I see it last night, and we had it set to a certain amount, and I put my hand, it's like, oh, that's a little too cold. Did you guys appreciate the temperature, I hope? Good. Hope you did. Because, it is really nice. A nice benefit of getting baptized here at Integrity Church, where we keep the water nice for you. It's great. Absolutely. Well, if the ushers would come up, let's just...
The only place we want to be lukewarm.
Right, exactly. Exactly. If the ushers would come up, we're going to prepare to receive our offering today. And I tell you, you just can kind of see the fruit of your giving here today. As you see people who are raised in the faith, and you see them make that decision to serve the Lord, as you give to this church, that message that brought them to this place is the thing that's going to change lives. And it is just so awesome to know that we serve a God who has given us so much abundance and that we can give back to him so that we can see the message of Jesus proclaimed and see lives change. So let's just rejoice in that today and realize that it's with great gratitude that we are able to give. So let's pray. Father God, we just love you so much, Lord. We're just so grateful that you provide for us abundantly. And as we give back to you a portion of what you've given us, Lord God, I pray that you would multiply it and use it to continually build your kingdom, Lord. We love you, God. We praise you for all of these things. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Hey, Connie.
Hello. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Integrity Church. Nice to see all of you this morning. We have a lot of stuff coming up that's exciting. One of them is that we'd love to have you join us as we head on over to the Timothy Hill Ranch in Riverhead on Saturday, September 23rd. So we're going to have a barbecue, games, a lot of music, and a lot of fun together with the youth and the young adult residents. The ranch will be providing food for us, so if you can register to let us know that you're coming, that would be awesome. And this is really going to be a great event, so we're hoping that a lot of people, hopefully everyone from the church, comes out and celebrates that day. Also, if you are a man or woman 16 years or older, there's a lot of you out here today, you can mark your calendars for our Pillars and Mosaic kickoff gathering. That'll be Tuesday, September 12th, starting at 7 p.m. Our women will be doing some sort of a baby shower on this night, collecting all size diapers and wipes for the Soundview Pregnancy Services. So women, if you can just bring diapers and wipes, that would be awesome, any size. And also, if anyone wants to bring a dessert, that would be super helpful. So guys and girls, look out for that night. We hope that you join us for that. Also, as you can see, there are some new faces. Maybe everyone's familiar to you. I know that there have been a lot of new people that have been joining the church. So if you are new, welcome. If you have been here for a long time and see a new face, welcome them. Say hello. Also, what makes it a little bit easier is putting your name on a name tag. Sometimes, I'll speak for myself, I can know someone's face or someone will know my face, and I just love when they have a name tag because then it's like a little cheat sheet for me. But it really just helps to get to know everyone. So if you feel comfortable putting on a name tag, that would be awesome, just to get to know everyone around. Also, we have the Connect cards in the seat in front of you. Many of you know about this, but if you don't, just put your name on there, let us know that you're joining us if you're visiting or new, and put it in the white box on the back wall so that we can connect with you and get to know you even more. Pastor Tom.
Now, I want you to notice Connie's color coordination. She got the orange looking here, right? And then the orange on there. So we do provide different colors so you can always coordinate as well. So it's a beautiful thing, yes. And actually, it's a no excuse for a name tag Sunday, because in front of you, you may find some name tags. So if you don't have one on, you could always just grab one of those, grab a pen, and put your name on it. But it's for this week only, okay? Because next week, you'll be able to get them. Actually, even this week, you can find them as soon as you come into the Welcome Center. That would be great, because it is important to know. Your names are very important to us. And in an effort to get to know each other even a little bit more, I know many of you should have received an email. And to get onto our church directory, we have a, on our app, if you go on there, you can see people who attend our church. You can see their pictures and some of their contact info. And this is just, again, another great way to match the names with faces. And if you have any questions about how to get onto it, how to get things going, how to get your picture uploaded, see me, or again, the email contains a lot of information, step-by-step instructions on how to do it. All right, so that would be really amazing if you could do that as we can continue to connect and grow as a family. Bob. Please welcome Bob. Yes.
And you all know me because of my... Fran, what does that say? No matter which way you spell it. Today's opening word for this morning is taken from Psalms 139, verses 1 through 6. If you could please stand for me, please. And thank Jesus for the blood applied. O Lord, you have searched me and know me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from afar. You search out my path and my lying down, and are acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, behold, O Lord, you know it altogether. You hem me in behind me and before me, and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high. I cannot attain it. This is the word for today. And if you wouldn't mind doing me a favor now, just say hello to everybody who's next to you, and I'm going to time you. It's only going to be 5 minutes. Thank you.
See you, brother. All right, he's only kidding about that 5 minutes thing. You have all afternoon. Good. Oh, it's always good to be able to connect with one another. I so much appreciate Pastor Tom's efforts in helping us to identify. It's always nice to know who we're around, right? It's always nice to be known. And it's interesting. We, by God's grace, since January, the church has grown over 35%. Isn't that incredible? Yeah. But if we don't build and grow in relationship with one another and as a community, that growth really doesn't mean very much. Numbers aren't impressive, right? What we want to do is we want to build community. We want to build in relationship with one another. And that truly is the most important thing. We don't want to be a big church. We want to be a family of God. And so one of the, you know, there's some tools, right? You have to be intentional sometimes about making that happen. And so I really want to encourage you to, again, the name tags are out there only this Sunday, because what will end up happening is there's going to be about 90 pieces of paper on the floor. And until we get a couple more cleaning crews signed up, there's a request for some cleaning crews. We're going to be offering them back there. But let's make that a little bit easier for one another, and jump on our app and our website. And because what's really cool is, what's so nice about the website or the app is when you get on there and you see the directory, you start seeing faces, you start knowing who to pray for. Because you know what? You'll never feel connected to your church if you're not praying for them. Right? I mean, how nice is it to know that there's people who go on the church directory, and when they see your face on there, they're praying for you. You may never know about it, right? But those are the things that build the community and allows us to kind of engage in one another. So I want to really encourage you to take advantage of that, and let's build something that will be honoring to God and effective in our community. Hey, some of your best friends could be sitting right around you. You don't even know it. Maybe some of your future spouses, unless you're married, of course, but may be here, right? And so, this is the family of God, and so we want to really make access to that. It's good to be back. I haven't preached on a Sunday morning, and this is in 3 weeks, but there's been some really good preaching that has fed my soul these last number of weeks, right? Starting with Rob Chestnut talking about just the hope that we have in Christ, and no matter what it looks like going on around us, man, we have this sure hope in Him, right? And Pastor Frank really encouraged our hearts and challenged us with about the joy of suffering, right? One of those messages that really nobody wants to be like, yeah, give me that, but the reality is we walk through seasons of suffering, and as children of God, there's joy in that journey. And then Pastor Josh preached on the subject of humility last week, and again, just really challenged each and every one of us. And so I'm just thankful that of the deep bench, right, the ability to just be fed by multiple people in the church, and it's just such a wonderful thing. Next week, I'm going to begin a new expository sermon series. That's kind of my sweet spot. I love to go through books of the Bible verse by verse so that we can get the full context and intent of the author. But next week, I'm going to be beginning a series in 1 John called That You May Know. And so we're going to be looking at that book verse by verse beginning next week. And so I want to encourage you to begin to familiarize yourself with it and ask the Holy Spirit to begin to prepare your heart. And let's learn together and as we journey through 1 John beginning next week. But this morning, something kind of was on my heart that I wanted to share with you and kind of on my return back. And I pray that it'll be a blessing to you. It certainly was to me. You know, these last couple of weeks, I was thinking back to those final moments that Jesus had with his disciples before he ascended up into heaven, right? There's like a 50-day period from that time where he entered the streets of Jerusalem on Palm Sunday to when he was crucified, risen, and then here for 40 days and ascended into heaven. But that period kind of started with Jesus entering into the streets of Jerusalem. Do you remember that? Historians tell us that over 2 million people were present in the streets of Jerusalem as Jesus entered the city riding on a donkey. And they were waving palm branches and crying out, "Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." And it was an appeal from the people for Jesus to set up a political kingdom right there and right then. They were doing things like throwing their cloaks on the ground, a sign that they would be willing to lay down their lives if Jesus would just go and take the throne of the day and establish himself as a king. The gospel writers remind us that as Jesus saw this, he began to weep because the people did not understand and know the hour of their visitation. They didn't realize that he did not come to set up an earthly kingdom, but a heavenly kingdom. And this very same crowd that sang his praises on Sunday morning were the same ones who pointed their finger at him and cried out, "Crucify him." He went from the top prospect to public enemy number one in just a matter of days. And the disciples had seen all of this. They had walked with Jesus. And you could, if you could allow yourself to just imagine for a moment what that must have been like, just that emotional roller coaster that they are on. One minute they're singing his praises. The next minute they're crying out, "Crucify him." They were there when he was arrested. His disciples watched as Jesus was beaten. They were there when he was crucified and when he was placed in the tomb. Imagine the emotional downshift that they had to embrace, because just a week earlier, they were singing his praises. Their Messiah, whom they waited for, this one that they walked with, and we're so close with, now lay lifeless in a tomb. But we know he didn't stay there, right? That's why we're here today, right? We're here because of the resurrected Savior, Jesus Christ. I think sometimes the reality of the resurrection causes us to kind of miss the significance of all the events that led up to that, because we kind of know the end of the story, and it's kind of easy for us to just kind of say, well, you know, eventually he comes back, but if we would just remember and consider what that moment must have been like. 3 days later, as the scripture said he would, and as Jesus declared he would, he rose from the dead. He conquers death and hell and the grave, and he rises from the dead. And he continues to walk with his people for 40 days, teaching and ministering. And how encouraged they must have been that their Savior, who is at one time in a tomb, is back again. His presence is with them. They're probably thinking, this is it. Surely he's not going to go anywhere again. But after the completion of the 40 days, we know that Jesus would eventually ascend back into heaven. It's what opened the pathway for the Holy Spirit to come as promised. Where the Holy Spirit would come not just with the disciples as Jesus would declare, but now the Holy Spirit would come within the disciples, God within his people. But prior to Jesus' departure, he would say some of the most encouraging of words. And it's that thought that I want us to focus upon this morning. We don't know exactly where on the timeline between the resurrection and the ascension that these words that Jesus is about to say kind of lie, where they find themselves. And it really doesn't matter when they were said so much as that they were said. And what I want to kind of bring us back to is when Jesus said in Matthew chapter 28 and verse 18, he said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age." Now, everything in this text is super significant to unpack, but I want to, this morning, I want us to kind of zoom in on something that really reveals the heart of God, the plan of God, the purpose of God, and God's purpose and plan for redemption. And it's found in those words, those final words, where Jesus said, "And behold, I am with you always, to the end of the age." Behold, I love that. It means get a hold of this. This group of disciples who have been through a roller coaster ride of emotion, I'm sure, found tremendous encouragement from those words. Behold, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. These are more than just words of encouragement and promise. I submit to you that they are words of prophetic fulfillment. I am with you always. God with his people. You see, that was the plan all along. It has always been the plan of God to be among his people, to restore that which was lost in the garden. God, when God created man, he created us with the intent of us being in relationship, in fellowship with our Creator. And we know that Adam and Eve walked with God until that dreaded day where they disobeyed God. They ate of the tree, and sin entered the world, and they were removed from the garden and separated from God. But thankfully, that story didn't end. As early on as Genesis chapter 3, we get a picture of God letting us know that there's a plan that's in place for God to restore that which was lost in the garden. And the biggest thing that was lost in the garden was God being with his people. It's the plan all along. All of the prophets point to this reality. All of the Old Testament can be viewed as a finger that points to the Messiah, the one that's going to come, who's going to redeem his people and restore that which was lost from the curse. Isaiah prophesied 750 years prior to Christ's birth. He writes, "Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel." That's not just a passage we read at Christmas time. That needs to be a reality every day of our lives. We shall call his name Emmanuel. It means God with us. This one that Isaiah prophesied about was going to come because God's desire and heart was to be with his people. This morning, I want to take a brief moment and consider this idea of the God who is always there for you. And let me just kind of let you know from the beginning, my heart's desire isn't so much to inform you. My guess is I'm probably not going to bring anything new to the table, but I want to encourage you and remind you and inspire you to remember that God, the one who loves you, is always with you. And I want to bring about four truths that I see clearly laid out in the scripture. But something that I'll be honest with you, a couple of weeks ago, I was laying down, I woke up in the middle of the night, and then there were four truths that hit my soul so loudly, it woke me up out of a deep sleep. I didn't hear an audible voice from God, but these words kind of came to my spirit and just brought such refreshment to my soul. And it was this: I have been with you in the past, I am with you today, I will be with you tomorrow, and I will be with you forever. That's what I woke up to. And I was like, what encouragement to my soul, and I thought, I want to share this with my family. It's not the deepest of truths, but I don't know about you, but I find that some of the simple things are the deepest of truths. And I think sometimes when we get so familiar with the simple things, we become familiar with them because we don't allow them to go deep enough. And so this morning, I just want to take a moment. That wasn't new information. We see this idea revealed for us all throughout the scripture, and I want to take a moment and look at that. This idea of God saying, I have been with you in the past. I am with you in the present. I will be with you tomorrow, and I will be with you forever. I have been with you in the past. I love this because it reminds me that before I was ever aware of it, God's presence was in my life. Mariah, you'd think you'd heard this message already. I so much appreciated Mariah sharing and saying, I didn't even know God had his hand on me. I didn't realize I was looking, but he got a hold of me before I even realized it. How many times can you look back at your journey and realize that you had no idea that the fingerprints of God were all over your life and you had no idea? God was there. Jeremiah was reminded of this by God as he is given this call by God to be a prophet to the nation. Look at Jeremiah chapter 1 and verse 4. It says, now the word of the Lord came to me, Jeremiah, saying, look, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Let's just stop there for a moment. Before I formed you, who formed you? God formed you. Before I formed you in the womb, God says, I knew you. You know, God cannot lie, right? He doesn't sensationalize. He doesn't exaggerate. This is reality. And what God is saying to Jeremiah is, before you were even formed in your mother's womb, I knew you. And he says, before you were born, I consecrated you. And I appointed you a prophet to the nations. I have been with you, Jeremiah, long before you ever knew it. Before I even formed you, I knew you. Can I just tell you this morning that God knew you? And God knows you. God knows you and me so well that he allows us to go through seasons of our lives that we begin to discover what's on the inside of our own selves because we don't even know ourselves as well as God knows us, right? Before I even formed you, Jeremiah, in the womb I knew you. Before you were born, I set you apart. I consecrated you. I appointed you a prophet to the nations. Listen to the psalmist, Psalm 139 in verse 1. He says, O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from afar. I love that. In other words, you see it before I even am aware that they're entering my mind. You discern my thoughts from afar. Look at verse 13. He says, look, for you formed my inward parts. You knitted me together in my mother's womb. What a beautiful picture of intimacy, the way in which God intentionally, strategically, like a designer, knits us together. How many are so glad that we didn't kind of slither out of a pond as a single cell amoeba that eventually evolved into all these different things over time, and here we are. No. We were formed and fashioned and knit together by God in the womb. That's why every life is so precious, born and unborn. He says, I praise you for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. It speaks of a sense of reverence and awe. Wonderful are your works, he says. My soul knows it very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in secret. I love that the Hebrew word there, secret, the Hebrew word there is sether. It literally means intimacy. When I was made in intimacy, when I was made in love by God, intricately woven in the depths of the earth. Where are the depths of the earth? Speaking of the womb, the unseen place where God intricately weaves his people together. What a beautiful picture of a great designer forming and fashioning his people. He says, you saw my unformed substance. Interesting. Could you imagine for a moment? See, we read these things and we say, that's really nice, but you know what? We need to know how to apply that to our reality. You see, you were knit together in your mother's womb by God. You were fearfully and wonderfully made. You are known by the creator of the universe. You are known by the designer of all things. He says, you saw my unformed substance. And in your book were written, every one of them, the days that were formed for me, when as yet there was none of them. Before my days were even a reality to me, you wrote what those days would look like. I don't know about you, but I don't have the mind, the ability to wrap my arms around that truth. I'm so limited in my ability to grasp the concept of that, and yet this is what the scripture says. Paul will echo those words in his opening to the church in Ephesus. He says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, even as he chose us in him, when? Before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him. In love, he predestined us. I love that. That was the drive behind it, right? In love, he predestined us for adoption to himself as sons through Jesus Christ. Why? According to the purpose of his own will. You see, sometimes we read those passages of scripture and it evokes so much emotion, so much debate, so much divide. It's such a powerful text of scripture, yet so much effort and angst is spent at trying to reconcile God's sovereignty and man's responsibility in this passage of scripture that we miss the very essence of what it's saying. Can I just let you know? You will never be able to reconcile man's responsibility and God's sovereignty. And so instead of focusing and dividing over the process, can we celebrate the results, right? The fact that, hey, before the foundation of the world, he chose me. In love, he predestined me. I don't know what that looks like. I don't know why he did it. I wouldn't have chosen me, but he did. And as a result of that, I'm a child of God, and so are you. Before I ever knew him, he knew me. He was there in my past. Before I was ever aware that God existed, he knew me and was with me. He is omnipresent. God is everywhere with all of himself all of the time. And he is omniscient. He knows everything there is to know about everything. And so you take his omnipresence and you take his omniscience, and we recognize that that is something that operates outside the arena of time in an eternal sense that we will never be able to understand on this side of eternity. And so we, as the clay, look to the potter and just love on him and bow to his sovereignty. I have been with you in the past. And God has been with you in the past, whether you realize it or not. Only eternity will reveal the times that God has stepped into your life to protect you or to provide for you. Only eternity will reveal, and we didn't even know about it, on this side of eternity. I've been with you in the past. We see it clearly in Scripture. We also see very clearly in Scripture that God says, I will be with you in the present. I will be with you now as well. We see this woven all throughout the scripture, God being with his people right then. The psalmist, going back to Psalm 139, I love the psalmist says, where shall I go from your spirit? Or where shall I flee from your presence? It's a rhetorical question. There's no place I could possibly go. How do you hide from an all-present God? He says, if I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me and your right hand shall hold me. I love that. He said, if I ascend to heaven, you are there. In other words, you are there in life. You are there in good times. You are there in all of life. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. He is there even in death. The psalmist will declare in chapter 23, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I'll fear no evil, for you are with me. And so we see the psalmist declaring that he's with us in life. He is with us in death. He said, if I take the wings of the morning, what is the wings of the morning? I sat out early this morning and watched the sun come up, and there was just such a peaceful moment this morning. If I take the wings of the morning, I'm reminded that God is there in times of peace. And then he says, and I dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea. What is that? Oftentimes throughout the scripture, the sea is ascribed to a time of chaos. It's a time of turbulent storm and difficult times. And so ultimately what the psalmist is saying here is, I am even here in times of chaos. Your presence is even there in life, in death, in peace, and in chaos. Where can I go from your presence? The psalmist will declare in chapter 46, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in times of trouble. I like that. A present help is really what it says there. He is a present help in times of trouble. Therefore, because he is a present help in times of trouble, therefore we will not fear. Though the earth gives way, and though the mountains, there it is again, be moved into the heart of the sea. Again, it's the picture of turbulence. It's a picture of a storm. It's a picture of chaos. I want you to kind of just mark that in your minds. I'll revisit that a little bit later. But when we see the idea of the sea in scriptures, it has to do with this idea of chaos and storm in turbulent times. Though the mountains be moved into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble at its swelling, the psalmist says, there is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation, the dwelling place of the Most High God. Even in the midst of the storm, God is present. You see, our awareness of God's presence in our lives, in our past, need to inform our awareness of God's presence in our lives, in our present. We need to learn from our past and take that which we've learned from our past and apply it to our present, especially when we find ourselves going through the storm, especially when we find ourselves going through difficult times of questioning. We need to look back and grab what we've learned from the past, that before we even were aware of it, God was involved and present in my life. And if he was present then, he would be present now. I've been with you in the past. I am with you in the present. Another truth we see woven throughout Scripture is that God says, I will be with you tomorrow as well. Too much energy is spent and sleep is lost over the fears of tomorrow, of the unknown. What will it be? One person said, today is the tomorrow that we worried about yesterday. And you know what? You made it. You're all right. Today is the tomorrow you worried about yesterday, and the same God who carried you yesterday will carry you today, and he will carry you tomorrow. You know, fear is one of the most effective tools in the enemy's arsenal. Why? Because it is the antithesis of faith. God is causing and raising us up and teaching us to be a people of faith. And nothing will challenge our faith like embracing and submitting to fear. And so the enemy tries to diminish our faith by filling us with fear. And what we need to do is we need to starve our fear and feed our faith and walk in the faith of God's word. How do we build our faith? Faith comes by hearing and hearing of the word of God. You say, well, how do I grow my faith? Get in the word. Listen, how do I get money in the bank? I put money in, right? It's very simple. You put money in, it grows. You spend time in the Word of God, it's going to feed and increase your faith. That's what God's Word says. It's not rocket science, folks. It's really not. You don't need to be a special son, special daughter. You just invest time into the Word of God, and you will see how God uses that to build your faith. Don't fear what tomorrow holds. Listen, because God is already there. He is eternal. He does not wait for tomorrow to present itself, because he is not in time. He is over time. Therefore, listen, he is already in your tomorrow. And because he's already in your tomorrow, you can rest assured that he will be with you. He is eternal. He is over time. Time is just something that is created for us here temporarily. God is not bound by it. God is not operating it. God is over it. And so therefore, we need not fear. Isaiah declares in chapter 43 of his writing, "But now thus says the Lord, he who created you, O Jacob, he who formed you, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters," that's future tense. In other words, listen, not if you pass. Doesn't say that. When you pass. "When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through fire, you shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you." Can I just tell you, there's a time and a season in every one of our lives where you're going to, as Isaiah says, pass through the waters. But the good news is you're passing through the waters. You're not drowning in the waters, right? You're passing through the waters. But there's a time in every one of our lives where we will experience that, where you will find yourself in the midst of the storm, where you will wonder whether God is aware of what you're going through. Does he know what my situation is? Where we begin to even question his presence in our lives. It's the reality of every believer at one time or another. Listen, even John the Baptist, when he was in prison, awaiting to be executed, sent his disciples to Jesus to ask the question, "Are you really the one? Or should I wait for another?" Hey, listen, if John the Baptist, the greatest man who ever lived according to Jesus, could have moments of questioning in this humanity, how many know I can eat at his table, right? There are seasons that God brings us through. But listen, God will allow you to go through times in your life where you won't feel his presence like you once had. Can I just tell you, that's the design of sanctification. That's the plan. That's how God does things. He always will bring you through seasons where your emotions aren't enough to get you from where you are to where God wants you to be. I see it happen when people come to the church. They come in, they're like, "Oh, this is great. I'm excited. I'm growing. The worship is amazing. I'm learning from the teaching. These people are wonderful. I'm just really feeling it," right? It's kind of like that honeymoon experience. And those are wonderful and they're beautiful, but they don't last forever. And there are times where God will then allow us to not feel it so much, right? It's those times where we're not getting as much out of everyone and everything, not because it's not effective anymore, but what is God doing there? He is calling you and causing you to go deeper yourself. Listen, the day that I, and what comes over this pulpit, is your only feeding source is the day that you are going to stall in your spiritual growth. This is never to be all that you get in the course of your week. The scripture calls us to give us this day our daily bread. We are to go to him regularly. And you see, God will allow those times into our life where we wonder, "God, where are you? I'm not feeling it anymore. No one understands me. I don't even understand myself." And he'll bring us to a place where all we have is his ear. And it's in those times that the character of God is being developed into your life. It's in those times. He says, "You'll seek me and you'll find me when you search for me with all of your heart. God loves when his people pursue him. And he will bring us to a place where all we have is the ability to pursue him. And what's on the other side of that is a spiritual growth and depth that only comes from growing, going through the storm. But even in those times, he is with us. He allows us to feel like his presence has lifted. Have you ever thought, you don't have to raise your hand. I'm thinking, Lord, I know I preached this, but are you really with me? In those moments where we step and live by faith. No, God, you know what? Your word says you'll never leave me and you'll never forsake me. I am not going to be controlled or governed by my feelings. I'm going to be controlled and governed by God's word. And I'm holding tightly on to that. And you see, that's what builds the character and the maturity that goes the distance. That's what Job learned. This man of God who experienced all the worst that life could throw at someone, right? His children are killed in a storm. His home and his livelihood are destroyed. His wealth was deteriorating. His wealth was, and his health are deteriorating. His friends aren't being helpful, nor is his wife at that point. And this man of God who at times earlier in his life enjoyed the presence and blessings of God like no other. How do I know that? Well, because Satan said that was the case. When he approached himself, he stood before God. And God said, hey, you see my servant Job, there's nobody like him in all the land. Right? You remember that conversation. But here he is now in the storm. And it was in that time we had nothing else to hold on to but God that he said these words in Job 23 and verse 10. Maybe it resonates. He says, behold, I go forward, but he is not there. And backward, and I do not perceive him. I look on the left when he is working, but I do not behold him. He turns to the right hand, but I do not see him. Have you ever felt like that? God, I know you're with me, but are you with me? I believe, help my unbelief. I look to the north, the south, the east, and the west. God, I don't see you. That's what Job came to. But he says this in verse 10, but he knows the way that I take. And when he has tried me, when he has matured me, when he is done with me, I shall come forth as gold. The only way you get from where you are to where God wants you to be is, listen, you're going to go through a storm. And it's in those times that God's presence, although maybe not felt, will always be with you. Our awareness of God's presence in our lives, in our past, needs to inform our awareness of God's presence in our lives, in our present, and our awareness of God's presence in our lives, in our present, needs to inform our awareness of God's presence in our lives, in our tomorrow. I have been with you in the past. I am with you in the present. I will be with you tomorrow. And then lastly, I will be with you forever. I will be with you forever. That's the end game, folks. God gathering his family together at the end, or the consummation of all things, when man is with his God for all of eternity. It's what Jesus pointed his worrying disciples to when just moments before he's letting them know that soon he's going to leave them, and he sees the look of worry on their eyes, and he says these words, let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go and prepare a place for you? In other words, would I mess with you? Would I tease you? Would I lie to you? He said, if I go and I prepare a place for you, I will come again and I will take you, speaking of the rapture, take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. That's the beauty, that's the design, that's the plan, that God would take us so that where he is, we may be also. It's the reversal of the curse, where now we will be forever in the presence of the Lord. I will be with you forever. The Apostle John on the island of Patmos gets a picture of this. He pens it for us in chapter 21 of Revelation. Look what he says. He says, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more." I mentioned earlier about the sea. Oftentimes people read that passage, they're like, wait a minute, there's not going to be any oceans in heaven? No water? I mean, how many people love the sea? I love the water. Like, that's really, I know everything's going to be better in heaven, but really, you're going to take away the sea? No, that's why I pointed out to you earlier before what oftentimes the scripture is referring to when it makes reference to the sea. It's not this, you know, this liquid that we enjoy, you know, surfing and swimming in, but rather it's the chaos, it's the turmoil, it's the storm. That is no longer going to be there. He says, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea, the chaos, was no more. Thank God for that. And he says, and I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, behold, the dwelling place of God is with man, and he will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God. It's the culmination of all things. Everything has been reversed and put back in order, where creation is now walking with Creator, and we are with God forever and ever and ever. And it says, he will wipe away every tear from their eyes. And death shall be no more, neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore. Why? For the former things have passed away. That's what awaits, church. That's what awaits. It is as sure as the integrity of God himself. This is the promise that the psalmist penned so many years ago, and he closes out that famous Psalm 23 where he says, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Hey, this life is short. And I don't know about you, but the older you get, the quicker it seems to go. They kind of said it's kind of like a roll of toilet paper. The closer you get to the end, the quicker it goes. And if all we had in this life was what 70, 80, what years we might have, how sad that is. But thankfully, that is not even a blip on the screen of what God has created for us. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we'll have no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun. And the most amazing thing about that moment is it'll be done in the presence of God. Don't get discouraged. Don't get distracted, child of God, by the things and the cares of this world that are so temporary. It's a simple truth, yet not so simple. After all, it needs to inform everything we do and see and believe. He is with us. I have been with you in the past. I will be with you. I am with you in the present. I will be with you tomorrow. And I will be with you forever. The psalmist said, where can I go from your presence? The answer is nowhere. The God who is always there for you. Let's pray. Father, I recognize that as we unpack these truths. So many people are in different places in life right now. This message will mean different things to different people depending on the circumstances they find themselves in, struggling with cancer and relationships and jobs and work and worry and all of those things. I pray, Lord, that you would take that which is from your word and you would allow that to eclipse the fears of tomorrow. That it would inform our mindsets. I pray, Lord, that you would come alongside those that find themselves in a weary day. Your word reminds us that you draw close to those of a broken heart. And I pray that, Lord, you would, as in a way that only you can, would you meet each person right where they're at today? That this word would bring forth fruit and encouragement and hope and life. And that would drive us to a passionate pursuit of you, the lover of our souls. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Let's stand together and respond to God in worship.
trials, you've always been faithful. You bring healing to my soul. I am not alone. I am not alone. You will go before me. You will never leave me. I am not alone. I am not alone. You will go before me.
Before and behind me.
I have one question. How good is he? Amen. Amen. Today's closing word is from Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20 to 21. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Now, everybody, if we take what we heard today and all the examples we saw, let's use that to change our lives forever and ever. Also, if you have any prayers, additional prayers that you need, don't hesitate to come up and talk to one of the elders, and we'll pray for you, and whatever you need, we can help you out with. And the other big thing is that there's a whole lot of bagels next door and a whole lot of coffee. And they're all on Kenny. We're putting it on Kenny's tab. So, go in peace. Thank you.